Good morning to you. It's Christmas Eve, 9:44 in the morning. This is my second try at this video. I was going up a hill. Actually, I'm sliding right now on some ice down the hill in my neighborhood. I was going up and somebody, electrician's work van had slid all over the place. So, I go sliding, just fishtailed on this damn ice. But anyway, let me get to it's been a week almost, and they still haven't plowed this stuff. So it's been a mess back here. But anyway, let's get to the point. It's just another day. It's kind of the same old shit, different day with me. So I'm going out just like yesterday. If you watched videos from Wednesday or yesterday, see, I've been going out. I have to go to my mom's house every day. She's out of town for Christmas with her sister to walk her dog and feed him and take care of the house and whatnot. But anyway, I'm on my way to do that again right now. And I left the computer uploading yesterday's videos. I recommend you check them out. You learn a lot. But I think I just wanted to touch on mystical experience and stuff like that. And I have a lot I can say about that, about mystical experiences. I've had several of them, quite a few actually. And all you guys are capable of them too. I'm no more special than any other person. You just have to tune in. It's almost like you change a channel in your mind. You can change it around, access to different kinds of energy. And like attracts like. Tune into positive thinking and you turn off the negative thought channels. You're just gonna draw a lot to you, you know? That's a good way to put it, you know? Like attracts like. You can create anything with your thoughts. But getting back to the experiences, I had one in mind that kept popping up in my mind this morning to talk about, a real special one. You know, like I said in this other video, I've had a crazy life, been in a lot of trouble before, I've been locked up several times, you know, drug charges, as always, you know, I've been a heroin addict, crackhead, a tweaker, so amphetamine user, speed addict, but stuff like that, and it's about every other thing. But anyway, I was locked up, anyway, it was about 2:00 in the morning one night, and I was in the hole actually for getting in a fight with somebody. This is about 10 years ago, almost 11 years ago now. But anyway, there was probably 6 of us back there in the hole down at a place called Southampton Receiving Center. It's a processing center for Virginia state prison system, you know, kind of process people and decide which joints to send them to. But anyhow, I'm back there, got in a fight, put in the hole. And a friend of mine from local Henrico jail was back there, a dude named Shalif, and about 5-6 other people. And we had all been back there for months, and months at a time. And there was just bars on the doors so we could talk all around. But, well, getting to the point, though, it was, you know, middle of the night, and then I happened to be in a good mood, you know. At times I've been incarcerated, I always managed to make the most of it, and I've had fun, made it enjoyable, and had a lot of good times, and met some cool people. You know, you can make anything fun, it's all in how you think about it. But, well, so I was sitting there just listening to some music on my walkman, and chilling, just hanging out with everybody, talking, bullshitting, and all of a sudden, this feeling just washed over me, you know. I never had a feeling like that before that I can remember, not that strong, you know. It was like energy was pouring over me, and it's like I started literally compassionately, emotionally, spiritually melting into the other inmates back there. You know, I just kind of melted into their being, you know, and formed it all, formed one collective mass of consciousness. That's what it felt like. It was the most incredible thing I've ever felt. You know, it was, just like falling in love with them, but it wasn't sexual. It was like, might think about how Buddha was compassionate and loved everybody, maybe other people too, Krishna, Lord Krishna, and Christ. It was kind of feeling like that, how you expect them to have loved everybody equally. But that was, it's hard, I can't really put it into words, but it was just one of the most incredible things that ever happened to me, you know. And the people back there weren't immune from it, you know. You could feel the whole vibe and the whole joint change, you know, as that happened. You could feel the other vibes going up, and the other people back there, my friends back there with me, getting happier and happier. You could see the mood change, and it was incredible, you know. And that taught me a lot. Of course, I think I already knew at that point all the stuff I'd been through up to that point, that I had love for everyday people and people that don't live a life that society approves of, you know. A lot of those people back there were doing 20, 30, 40 years, you know. And these are all young people, you know. This place, the oldest people there were maybe me and Shalit. And he's still active. He's doing 30 years for a murder charge. But anyway, though, if you can see the good side and show love and see what's good about a bunch of criminals and murderers, you know, how society wants to turn them, you know, how are you going to think, what does that tell you about the nature of the universe? I mean, if everybody has a good side, how is anybody going to be condemned to some hell? I know I've touched on the subject a few times, but I'm going to do it one more time because it's so important. There is no hell that God throws people in. There just isn't. I know that for an absolute fact. There's no eternal punishment. None of that. None of that is true. It's all a lie. It's all made up by some humans along the line, along the millennia, as a control mechanism to try to increase the power of the church, to get people to think that they have to have the church for forgiveness and to reach God, that you have to have an intermediary. That, and you know, people paid for absolution of sins centuries ago. And the Catholic Church, I forgot what it's called. It was called indulgences. And they had different kinds of indulgences, depending on how much money you could give the church. And the indulgence was assurance that, you know, that your slate's white clean and you're not going to go to hell, that you're forgiven for everything, no matter what you do. You see, it's almost laughable, you know, that people actually believe that, but they did. It's just laughable. But it happened, though. And that's how it started, though. There's indulgences, and, you know, and then somebody created the idea of an angry God, a pissed off God, judging people for mistakes, and it just kind of built upon that. But even the Catholic Church has admitted that the Bible is incomplete, that they've actually taken out various sections of it. If you look it up on the internet, you'll find that, and you'll see that I'm correct about that. They won't tell anyone what the sections say. They refuse absolutely to do that. They won't say what the sections they decide to take out of the Bible said. You have to wonder what they said. It's probably something that didn't make the church look too good. That's a pretty easy guess. But, if universe sees love and compassion and to people who do so-called bad things, there just can't be any hell and condemnation of anyone. There's I just see no way for that. So, something to keep in mind when you think about this stuff and when you hear our preachers.